Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Today, inshallah, we will cover a new topic, which is breast anatomy. First of all, the location and description. The breasts are specialized accessory glands of the skin that secrete milk. They are present in both sexes and share similar structure in male and immature females. The nipples are small and they are surrounded by colored area of the skin, which is called as areola. The breast tissue consists of a system of the ducts embedded in the connective tissue that does not extend beyond the margin of the areola. That is, the ducts are present only in this region, that is the areola region. See here in this diagram, you can see the nipple, the colored area which is around the nipple, which is called as areola, and you can see the ducts which are present here in the region of the areola. Okay, see here in this diagram also, these are the ducts which are present in the region of the areola. At puberty, in females, the breast gradually enlarge. See here, the breast gradually enlarge and assume their hemispherical shape. Hemispherical means it is half spherical shape under the influence of the ovarian hormones. The ducts elongate, okay, because we have studied that the ducts are present only in the region of the areola in the immature female. But at puberty, what will happen? The ducts elongate. They will elongate or increase in length, but the increased size of the gland is mainly from the deposition of the fat. Okay, this is fatty tissue which is present here. All fat is present and this will increase the size of the breast. The base of the breast, see here in this diagram, it will extend from second rib. See here, this is second rib and it will extend up till the sixth rib and from the lateral margin of the sternum to the mid axillary line. This is the extension of the breast. Okay, again I will explain. The base of the breast extend from second rib to sixth rib and from the lateral margin of the sternum to the mid axillary line. The greater part of the gland lies in the superficial fascia. A small part which is called as axillary tail, it extends upwards and laterally, pierces the deep fascia and at the lower border of the pectoralis major muscle, and it enters the axilla. Okay, so this is axillary tail. It will pierce the deep fascia at the lower border of the pectoralis major muscle and it will enter the axilla. Each breast consists of 15 to 20 lobes. See here in this diagram, each breast consists of 15 to 20 lobes which radiate out from the nipple. The main duct from each lobe opens separately on the summit of the nipple. This is the lobe, okay, and this is the separate duct from this lobe which is opening into the nipple, and it possesses a dilated ampulla just before its termination, okay, which will be shown in some other diagram, that each duct will have the ampulla which will be present at the termination. The base of the nipple is surrounded by areola, as we have discussed. Tiny tubercles on the areola are produced by the underlying areolar glands. The lobes of the glands are separated by fibrous septa that serve as a suspensory ligaments. Okay, in between the lobes there will be suspensory ligaments which are present, which are separating the lobes. A space filled by the loose connective tissue called as the retromammary space. This is the retromammary space. Retro means behind and mammary gland is for the breast. So it is behind the breast. This space lies deep to the breast and superficial to the underlying pectoral muscle. This is pectoralis major muscle and there will be pectoralis minor muscle. So above the muscle or superficial to the pectoral muscles, there will be the retromammary space which is deep to the breast. Okay. In young women, the breasts tend to protrude forward from a circular base. Now, what happens in the early pregnancy? There will be some changes in the pregnancy. In early months of the pregnancy, the duct system rapidly increases in length and as well as in branching. The branches of the ducts will increase and the size of the ducts will also increase. The secretory alveoli develop at the end of the small ducts. Okay, there will be secretory alveoli and the connective tissue becomes filled with expanding and budding secretory alveoli. Okay. Okay, the vascularity of the connective tissue also increases to provide the adequate nourishment to the developing gland. The nipple enlarges and the areola become darker and more extensive as a result of the increased deposits of the melanin pigment in the epidermis. The areolar glands enlarge and become more active. See here in this diagram, this is the showing the changes in the early pregnancy. Okay, so this is the nipple. The size of the nipple will be increased. The areola become more darker. Okay, then there will be enlarged alveoli in the mid-pregnancy. There will be enlarged alveoli. Okay, in lactation, there is dilated alveoli also. Okay. See here in this diagram, this is the nipple and the areola and the ducts in the female before puberty. Okay, which is just like the nipple and the areola and the ducts of the young and the adult male. But what happens at puberty? The size of the nipple will increase, the areola will enlarge, and the ducts will be more branched and increase in size. Okay, then in the female, in the first half of the menstrual cycle, same, the branching will increase. Okay, and in the second half of the menstrual cycle, see here, there will be no secretory alveoli. In pregnant female, there are more secretory alveoli. The ducts will increase in size as well as in branching. And lactating female, these secretory alveoli, they are filled with the secretions. But after the cessation of the lactation, again, there will be the condition as in the puberty. Okay, then this is after menopause. So these are the development of the ducts and the secretory alveoli in the breast in both sexes at different stages of the activity. In the late pregnancy, what happens during the second half of the pregnancy, the growth process slows. However, the breast continue to enlarge mostly because of the distension of the secretory alveoli with a fluid secretion called as colostrum. Okay, we know this thing that the initial secretion before milk is called as colostrum. Okay, so see here in this diagram, the fatty tissue fills the spaces around the ducts and the lobules. The lobules are producing more milk during pregnancy and the breastfeeding. The areola is dark circle of the skin that surround the nipple. It will increase in size. The duct which are carrying the milk from the lobules during the breastfeeding. The nipple is the outlet for the milk during breast secretion. The fibrous tissue to support the breast, making them feel firm, and these are the suspensory ligaments of the Cooper, which are in between the breast lobes. Okay, ribs can be felt beneath the skin, and there are chest muscles which help move your arm, and this is the pectoralis minor muscle, and there will be pectoralis major muscle, and this is the fascia. Okay, so this is, these are the changes which are in the late pregnancy. Now what happens post weaning? Okay, the breast return to their inactive state once the baby has been weaned. Okay, the remaining milk is absorbed, the secretory alveoli shrink, and most of them disappear. The interlobular connective tissue thickens, the breast and the nipples shrink and return nearly to their original size. The pigmentation of the areola fade, but the area never lightens to its original color. Okay, so we can see here in the post-weaning stage after lactation, what will happen? The secretory alveoli shrink and most of them disappear. Okay, the interlobular connective tissue will be thickened and the breast and the nipple, they shrink and return nearly to the original size. Now what happens after menopause? The breast atrophies after the menopause. Most of the secretory alveoli disappear, leaving behind the duct. The amount of the adipose tissue may decrease or increase. The breast tend to shrink in size and becomes more pendulous. The atrophy after menopause is caused by the absence of the ovarian estrogen and the progesterone. See here in this diagram, these are the changes in the postmenopausal breast. Okay, see here, the glandular tissue and the stroma is replaced with the fat, and the breast is more pendulous. There is atrophy. Okay, now what is the blood supply of the breast? See here, from the exit, the blood supply is from the axillary artery via the lateral thoracic branches and the thoracoacromial branches. This is the lateral thoracic branch. See here, this is the lateral thoracic branch and this is the thoracoacromial artery. Okay, then there will be the blood supply from the internal thoracic artery via its perforating branches that pierces the first to fourth intercostal spaces, then transfers the pectoral major muscle to reach the breast along its medial edge. This is present over the medial edge. The first and the second perforators are the largest of its branches. So these are the perforating branches of the internal thoracic artery, which is supplying the breast. Then the blood supply is from the intercostal arteries via their lateral perforating branches. Okay, the venous drainage is through the corresponding veins. There will be axillary vein, there is internal thoracic vein, there are intercostal veins. Okay, so remember the axillary artery, internal thoracic artery and intercostal arteries for the arterial supply. Now what is the lymphatic drainage of the breast? The lateral quadrant of the breast drains into the anterior axillary or the pectoral group of the lymph nodes. Anterior axillary are also called as pectoral group of the lymph nodes. The lateral quadrant will go into the anterior axillary. The medial quadrant drain by the means of vessels that pierce the intercostal spaces and they enter the internal thoracic group of the nodes along the course of the internal thoracic artery. As we know that the internal thoracic artery is present on the medial side. So medial quadrant will be drained to the lymph nodes which are present around the internal thoracic artery. A few lymph vessels follow the posterior intercostal arteries and drain posteriorly into the posterior intercostal nodes along the posterior intercostal arteries. Some vessels communicate with the lymph vessels of the opposite breast and with those of the anterior abdominal wall. See here in this diagram, this is the lateral group of the lymph nodes which are draining in the anterior axillary or the pectoral lymph nodes. Then on the medial side, the medial quadrant will be drained in the internal thoracic lymph nodes. So remember the lymphatic drainage of the breast. See here again, this type, this is the lateral quadrant. Okay, the lateral quadrant will be drained in the axillary lymph nodes and this is the medial quadrant. It will be drained into the internal thoracic lymph nodes. Now we will discuss the axillary lymph nodes. Yeah, these are 20 to 30 in number. They drain not only the lymphatics of the breast but also those of the pectoral region, upper abdominal wall and the upper limb, and they are arranged in 5 groups. Number 1 is anterior group. Okay, anterior group is lying deep to the pectoralis major muscle along the lower border of the pectoralis minor muscle. So this is anterior axillary lymph nodes, and because they are present deep to the pectoralis major along the lower border of the pectoralis minor, that's why they are named as pectoral lymph nodes. Number 2 is the posterior axillary lymph nodes. These are along the subscapular vessels. These are subscapular, along the subscapular vessels, that's why they are named as subscapular lymph nodes. Then we have the lateral axillary lymph nodes, which are along the axillary vein. See here, this is axillary vein, and along the axillary vein or around the axillary vein, there are lateral axillary lymph nodes. Then we will see the central lymph nodes. They are present in the axilla or in the axillary fat. Then we have the apical axillary lymph nodes, through which all other axillary lymph nodes drain immediately behind the clavicle at the apex of the axilla above the pectoralis minor muscle and along the medial side of the axillary vein. See here, this is the medial side of the axillary vein. It is below the clavicle and above the pectoralis minor muscle. So these are named as apical axillary lymph nodes. Again, you can see all axillary lymph nodes which are present here. Lateral lymph nodes are also called as the humeral lymph nodes. Then we have central lymph nodes, we have apical lymph nodes, then we have posterior or subscapular lymph nodes, and we have anterior or pectoral lymph nodes. See this diagram. This is pectoral or anterior lymph nodes. This is humeral lymph nodes or the lateral lymph nodes. Then we have subscapular or the posterior lymph nodes, which will drain into the central lymph nodes. And the central will ultimately drain into the apical lymph nodes, which will drain in the supraclavicular lymph node and ultimately into the subclavian lymphatic trunk. Again, the same diagram. This is the posterior lateral one, okay, which are also called as the humeral lymph nodes because they are along the humerus. Then this is the posterior group of the lymph nodes, which are also called as the subscapular. This is pectoral or anterior lymph nodes. These are central lymph nodes, and this is the apical lymph nodes, which are below the clavicle and above the pectoralis minor muscle. Now the lymphatic drainage and the carcinoma of the breast. The lymph vessels from the medial quadrant of the breast pierce the second, third and fourth intercostal spaces and enter the thorax to drain into the lymph nodes along the side of the internal thoracic artery. The lymph vessels from the lateral quadrant of the breast drain into the anterior or the pectoral group of the lymph nodes. It follows therefore a cancer occurring in the lateral quadrant of the breast tend to spread to the axillary lymph nodes and the thoracic metastasis are difficult or impossible to treat, but the lymph nodes of axilla can be removed surgically. approximately 60% of the carcinoma of the breast occur in upper lateral quadrant. See here, 50 to 60% will occur in the upper lateral quadrant. The lymphatic spread of the cancer to the opposite breast, to the abdominal cavity, or into the lymph nodes in the root of the neck is caused by the obstruction of the normal lymphatic pathway by the malignant cells or destruction of the lymphatic vessels by the surgery or the radiotherapy. The cancer cells are swept along the lymph vessels and they follow the lymph stream. The entrance of the cancer cells into the blood vessels account for the metastasis in the distant bone. This slide is very, very important, which will tell you the importance of the lymphatic drainage in the spread of the cancer. Now, why there is radial incision in the mastectomy or radial incision in the breast operation? Because of the presence of the fibrous septa, the infection remains localized to one compartment or one lobe to begin with. Abscesses should be drained through a radial incision. Okay, when there is abscess, it will be drained through a radial incision to avoid spreading of infection into the neighboring compartments. A radial incision also minimizes the damage to the radially arranged ducts. Now, what is the importance of the fibrous septa? The interior of the breast is divided into 15 to 20 compartments. As we have discussed before, that there are 15 to 20 lobes that radiate from the nipple by the fibrous septa that extend from the deep surface of the skin. Each compartment contains a lobe of a gland. Normally, the skin feels completely mobile over the breast substance. However, should the fibrous septa become involved in the serous carcinoma or in a disease such as the breast abscess, which result in the production of the contracting fibrous tissue, the septa will be pulled on, causing the dimpling of the skin. The fibrous septa are sometimes referred to as the suspensory ligament of Cooper or suspensory ligament of the mammary gland, okay, which are present in between the lobes. So this was the lecture about the breast. I hope you understand. Thank you very much.